This is the story of the 101 Dalmatians, brought to you at Disney Vintage. Chapter 1, A Damn Beginning. Not long ago, there lived in London a Dalmatian called Pongo. Pongo had a human pet, Roger Radcliffe. Like most humans, Roger thought that people owned their dogs, but like most dogs, Pongo knew better. Two young bachelors would probably have lived on in their cluttered little flat if Pongo hadn't happened to look out of the window one fine spring day. He was looking out of the window because he was tired of looking at the mess inside the flat. Dirty coffee cups were piled high on the mantelpiece, one of Roger's ties was draped over the lampshade, and papers were scattered all over the floor. Roger was a songwriter, and as he sat at the piano, humming and playing tunes, he was apt to forget about such unimportant things as waste paper baskets and ashtrays. Something has to be done, thought Pongo as he gazed out of the window. Suddenly, Pongo sat up very straight. A beautiful Dalmatian, her head carried high, was trotting demurely past the window. With her was an equally beautiful lady. That's it, thought Pongo. We need mates, preferably tidy ones, and those two look just right. It was just 4:15 by the battered old clock on the mantel. Pongo always took Roger for a walk promptly at 5 o'clock. It was an easy matter for Pongo to turn the hands of the clock forward with his nose. Then he barked to attract Roger's attention. Said Roger. Is it 5 already? He absentmindedly set his watch hands to match those of the clock, and then he searched for his hat.
Time for your walk in the park, old boy, said Roger. Now, where is your leash?
But Pongo was already holding it in his mouth, his tail wagging joyfully.
We must hurry, thought Pongo. I will be too far behind.
And as Roger opened the door, the dog leaped forward with a bound, tugging his pet behind him. Pongo headed for the park, pulling so hard on the leash that Roger almost had to run to keep up with him.
Pongo boy, cried Roger. Take it easy, what's a hurry?
But the dog hurried on, looking this way and that, darting down side paths, and peering to shaded nooks. And suddenly, he found them. The girl was seated on a bench reading, and the beautiful Dalmatian was by her side, watching the swans in the lake. It was a perfect situation, Pongo knew, if he could only take advantage of it.
I can't depend on Roger, thought Pongo. I know what he'll do. He'll settle down on the grass and puff his pipe, and that will be it. It's up to me.
Pongo led Roger slowly past the bench. Roger was staying straight ahead, but the girl looked up from her book, and her dog cast Pongo a shy glance. Then Roger did exactly what Pongo had expected. He sat down on the grass, with his back to the girl, and slowly puffed his pipe.
Quickly, Pongo snatched Roger's hat from his head and started to cavort about the bench.
Pongo!
Oh, you crazy hound! Shouted Roger.
Come on, let's have it back, boy. But Pongo continued his gambling and finally dropped his hat on a young lady's bench. It worked. Roger had finally seen the girl. But as Pongo continued to bark wildly, chase pigeons, and generally show off, the girl gave a sigh of exasperation and closed her book.
Come, Perdita, she called to her dog. There's no use trying to read.
They rose to leave.
Roger caught Pongo with a flying tackle,
and snapped the leash onto his collar. "Come on, you old renegade," he said. "We're going home. You know, Pongo, you're getting to be quite a rascal. What's come over you?"
Roger turned resolutely toward home.
But Pongo wasn't giving up without one more try. In desperation, he ran around the girl and wheeled back in a circle towards Roger, winding the two of them up in his leash.
I'm sorry.
I beg your pardon.
Be careful.
I stammered Roger as he and the girl struggled to keep their balance.
Well, I never in all my life...
The girl started to say, but the rest of her words were lost in a loud splash. Roger and the girl had fallen into the lake. The girl's dog looked on in shocked silence while Pongo, trying to make amends, retrieved the girl's hat. Oh, it was a catastrophe.
Oh,
wailed the girl.
My new spring suit and my new hat.
Roger was flustered and contrite. Please, he said, let me help you up.
I'm so sorry, my dog has never acted this way before.
Never mind, said the girl. Just go away.
She reached into her purse for a handkerchief to dry her face, but the handkerchiefs were as wet as the rest of her. Here, said Roger gallantly, as he reached into his pocket. Take mine. Roger made a ridiculous picture as he stood damply in the pond, holding out a dripping kerchief. The girl began to giggle, and then to laugh. Roger grinned sheepishly. Finally, both of them burst into shrieks of laughter. Pongo could hardly believe his ears. Somehow, his plan had worked. There's no figuring out humans, he thought, or females of any kind for that matter. The girl's dog was looking at him shyly, and he knew he'd been forgiven.
Chapter 2. Cruella de Vil. After that, the two dogs and their pets often walked together in the park, and the meeting that had begun in so cold and wet a fashion deepened into warm affection. The girl's name, Pongo learned, was Anita. Her dog was Perdita, and Pongo thought it the prettiest name he had ever heard. It wasn't long before Roger and Anita were married, an arrangement that suited Pongo and Perdita admirably. The four of them moved into a small house near the park. It was a modest little house, but just right for two couples who were starting out. Roger worked at his meeting on the top floor in quarters considerably tidier than the old bachelor flat. There was now a round little dumpling of a maid called Nanny, who was a wonderful cook and housekeeper. She was such a kind and understanding soul that Pongo often said he considered her almost canine. Life in a little flat was pleasant and uneventful for the first few months. And then, Cruella de Vil began to pay them visits. She was a strange woman, an old school friend of Anita's. Roger heartily disliked her, and as for Pongo and Perdita, their instinct was to stay as far away from her as possible. One day, Roger was searching for suitable words to fit his new melody. A screech of brakes drew him to the window, and he groaned. There she is again, Cruella de Vil. He turned back to his piano, and suddenly he let out a wild yell.
Cruella de Vil. That's it.
He started to sing.
Cruella de Vil, Cruella de Vil. If she doesn't scare you, no evil thing will.
Oh,
to
Roger.
See her is to take a sudden chill. Cruella, Cruella, she's like a spider waiting for the kill.
Roger, look she'll out. Hear you.
Said Anita, as Cruella swept into the house, trailing her furs behind her.
Anita, darling, how are you? Gushed Cruella. And how are your little spotted friends?
She looked thoughtfully at Perdita and Pongo. They have such
perfectly beautiful coats.
The two dogs backed away nervously.
When do you expect the puppies, and how many of them?
Oh, 6 or 7, answered Anita. And sometimes as many as 9 or 10.
But we won't know for another 3 weeks or so.
Cruella smiled a crafty smile.
Let me know when they arrive, won't you, dear?
She said,
and she departed with a swish of her black and white furs.
Oh, Pongo, said Perdita. What does it mean? Why does she want our puppies? That's all she's after, I know it.
Don't worry, Purdy, soothed Pongo. Nothing's going to happen to them. Our pets will see to that. But Perdita still felt terrified of Cruella.
Chapter 3. Puppies and more puppies.
The puppies were born one wild and stormy night late in October. Pongo and Roger waited anxiously in the kitchen, while Nanny excitedly announced the arrival of first 8 puppies, and then 2 more, then 3 additional ones, and finally 15 in all.
15! Exclaimed Roger. Pongo, old boy, can you imagine 15?
There was a flash of lightning and a roll of thunder, and Cruella de Vil burst unannounced into the room.
15 puppies, she cried. How marvelous, how perfectly, perfectly marvelous.
And before anyone could stop her, she strode over to Perdita's basket and looked down at the puppies.
Why, they're mongrels. No spots at all, cried Cruella in disgust.
There are not mongrels, snapped Nanny Cook. They'll get their spots. Just wait and see.
That's right, added Anita. They'll have their spots in a few weeks.
Cruella smiled an evil smile and reached into her purse for a checkbook.
Oh, well, she said. In that case, I'll take them all. The whole litter. Just name your price.
Oh, I'm afraid we can't give them up, answered Anita. Perdita and Pongo would be heartbroken.
Don't be ridiculous, snapped Cruella. You can't possibly afford to keep them. You can hardly feed yourselves. What are you going to live on? Roger's songs?
She laughed rudely.
Come now, Anita. When can the puppies leave their mother? In 2 weeks? 3 weeks?
Roger had been fuming in the background. But now, though he trembled a bit, he stepped forward and stammered.
We're not selling the puppies. Not a single one. Understand? And that's final.
Why, you horrible man, screeched Cruella.
Keep the little beast for all I care, but I warn you, I'll get even with you, you fools, you idiots!
And stalking out of the house, Cruella slammed the door behind her so hard that its pane of glass shattered into 100 pieces.
Oh, Roger, cried Anita joyously. You were magnificent, darling.
Anika clasped her hands in glee.
Oh, she cried. He was a blooming hero, ma'am. Indeed, he was a blooming hero.
Quickly, Pongo ran to break the good news to Perdita.
Purdy, he cried. We're keeping the puppies, every single one of them.
My old pet Roger told of that Cruella woman. She's gone for good.
Oh, Pongo, sighed Perdita. So happy.
Chapter 4. The Dog Nappers. They would not have been so happy had they known what Cruella was planning. Over a grimy table in the back room of a tavern, Cruella was talking to 2 villainous-looking men. One was tall and thin, the other short and fat, but both had shifty eyes and an evil look about them. These were the Baddens, Jasper and Horace.
Listen carefully to me, you two, said Cruella sternly. I must have those Dalmatian puppies. Now, let me explain my plan to you.
All was happy, if not exactly quiet, in the little house, until one snowy night in December. The puppies had grown, and were now tumbling all over the house. They were more than a handful for Pongo and Perdita, but they loved their pups dearly, all 15 of them. That evening, the pups had been particularly rowdy. It was with a sigh of relief that Perdita at last found the smallest pup, Lucky, and tucked him safely into the basket with the others. and were soon all asleep. Come on, Purdy, said Pongo. It's time for a walk. They brought their leashes to Roger and Anita, and the four of them set out into the park. In a rickety little truck around the corner, the two Buttons watched. There they go for their evening walk, said Jasper.
Yes, answered Horace. And nobody home but the little old cook. Let's get on with our business.
Stepping up to the front door, Horace pressed the doorbell, and Nanny came to answer the ring.
Oh, we're here to inspect the wiring and the switches, said the Buttons.
We're from the electric company.
Oh, but we didn't call for any inspection, said Nanny, and started to close the door.
It's for your own safety, ma'am,
said Horace, and the two Russians shouldered their way into the house.
What's the matter with you two? Shouted the furious Nanny. If you don't get out of this house, I'll call the police.
But while Nanny attached herself firmly to one of the Baron's coattails and chased him up and down stairs, the other had accomplished its purpose. In just a matter of moments, the two villains had left through the front door as quickly as they had entered.
Why, those good-for-nothing hoodlums, sputtered Nanny. They're nothing but common sneak thieves. I'll bet they've made off with the best silver.
She rushed to look, but the silver was undisturbed.
They were up to something, I'll be bound, she said. They just wouldn't be. Oh, the puppies! The puppies! They're gone!
Panic-stricken, Nanny rushed into the street, but it was too late. The Baddens and their truck and the 15 puppies had disappeared around the corner.
Those scoundrels! They took the puppies! Cried Nanny. Police! Help! Oh, can anybody hear me?
No one did, and Nanny sank, sobbing, to the curb. Chapter 5, The Twilight Park. The papers were full of the news the next morning.
Dog napping, 15 puppies stolen, said the headlines.
There were pictures of the puppies and their parents and photos of Anita and Roger. Cruella grinned as she saw the pictures.
Anita and her bashful Beethoven pipe and all, she laughed. Oh, Roger, what a fool you are!
The ring of the phone interrupted her gleeful perusal of the papers. It was one of the Baddons, and he was frightened.
We want our money, said Jasper. The story's in all the papers, with pictures and all. We're getting out of this.
Idiot! Shrieked Cruella. How dare you call me here?
You'll get not one penny until the job's finished. Do you hear?
She slammed down the phone. But she picked it up again almost immediately.
Oh, Anita, what a dreadful thing, she cooed. I just saw the papers. I couldn't believe it. About the stolen puppies.
Yes, Cruella, answered Anita. It was a shock. We're doing everything possible. We even called Scotland Yard, but nothing's been found out yet.
She's still number one suspect in my book, grumbled Roger when Anita had put the phone down. She's been investigated by Scotland Yard and is supposedly innocent.
But I don't know.
Pongo looked at them sadly and walked back to Perdita. Purdy, he said, I'm afraid our pets are getting nowhere in their search for our puppies. It looks as if it's up to us. Perdita was tearful.
Oh, Pongo, she wept. Isn't there any hope?
Yes, replied Pongo. The Twilight Bark.
But it's just a gossip chain, began Perdita.
It's still the fastest way to send news, said Pongo. And if our puppies are anywhere in the city, the London dogs will know. We'll send the word tonight. It was late and almost dark when Roger and Anita led the two Dalmatians into the park and to the top of Primrose Hill. Pongo barked the alert, three loud barks and a long howl. At first, there was no reply. But finally, there came an answer.
"Purdy," said Pongo. "We're in luck. It's the Great Dane over at Hampstead."
And Pongo barked out the message.
"Pongo! Quiet, boy!" exclaimed Roger. "Do you want to stir up the whole neighborhood? Come on, old fellow. We're going home."
But the message had been delivered. Over at Hampstead, the Great Dane was trying to decode the message. A little terrier frisked impatiently about him, bursting with question.
"What is it, Danny? Who's on the telegraph?"
"It's Pongo, right in Spark. It's an old dog alert," answered Danny.
"What's it all about? What's the word, Danny?"
urged the small dog.
"Wait a minute,"
said Danny, as he translated the barks and yips and howls into the final understandable message.
"Well, now, that is something. 15 puppies stolen, Dalmatians."
15 puppies?" said the terrier. "Stolen?"
"Yes," replied the Great Dane.
"No one knows who did it. Not a clue, not a trace. They've even called Scotland Yard. The humans have tried everything. Now it's up to us dogs to find them through the twilight bark. I'll send the alert."
The big dog's voice boomed into the night. Three loud barks and a long howl. Soon, the answering bark started coming in from miles away, every dog wanting to hear the latest news. Big Danny barked out the message, and from setter to collie, from bulldog to Labrador, the news was relayed. In a London back alley, two old mongrels heard the message as they rummaged through the rubbish cans for food. Said one,
"Those puppies aren't in London. They could be anywhere for Plymouth to Newcastle by now."
"Rusty, old lad," said the other. "What do you say we send the word all over England?"
"That's an idea," agreed the first. "I'll leg it for the station at Charing Cross. There are always some dogs going out by freight."
"I'll take the waterfront and tell all the barge dogs," said the other. "Shake a leg, mate."
At the River Thames, a small dog on a passing barge barked him a greeting and in return received Pongo's message as the barge slowly moved by. The little barge dog wasted no time. As his vessel moved slowly along the moonlit river, he barked the alert at intervals, and to answering greetings, he set out Pongo's message. The message finally reached the ears of an old hound standing on a hill.
"What's going on, Towser?"
asked an inquisitive goose as she joined him on the hilltop.
"What's all the gossip?"
"Ain't gossip, Lucy," he answered. "It's a message all the way from London. 15 puppies have been stolen."
"There are no puppies around here," answered the goose, "except those of Alan's, and they're all grown up now."
"Then it's up to me to send the word along," answered the old hound. "It'll be up to me to reach the colonel. He's the only one within barking range."
The goose looked up to the dark night sky.
"Oh, you'll never reach him at this hour,"
she warned, waddling off down the hill.
"I can try," said Towser to himself. "I'll bark all night if I have to."
He cleared his throat, and once again, the alert call went